Hi, good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to today's session on embedding accessible low-tech strategies in your data literacy approach. That was a mouthful, but this is a skills up session in the CarpentryCon at home series that's been happening. My name is David Opoku. I am a self-proclaimed data plumber, and I'll be sharing some experiences that I have gained from delivering data literacy trainings and initiatives across the world for the past 5 years. The objectives for this session are that you will come out of this having a sense of what low-tech or resource-constrained populations mean, understand the need to pay attention to low-tech stakeholders, be able to pick up some strategies that make data literacy approaches more accessible to low-tech stakeholders. And finally, hopefully you'll be able to learn enough and be excited to explore more afterwards. The outline for this section is listed here. We have some definition activities. We'll dive into why low-tech strategies matter, do some data literacy scenarios, and which will then lead us to into individual and group activities. And then finally, we'll come back and delve into some of the strategies that at least I call data literacy 2.0 strategies and end with questions and clarifications. So hoping to do this in the next 75 minutes of interactive activities. So let's start off. What does low tech entail? Which brings us to our first 5 minute activity. So we want to understand what low tech means to you. And I encourage you to take a pause and do this activity yourself because I find that it will be helpful with subsequent things that we do. So first, list the words that come to mind when you hear low tech. So take a minute and list the words that come to mind when you hear low tech. You can do this on your own. Write that in the Etherpad or something that you have access to. Once you're done with that, take 2 minutes and use any resource available to you, dictionary, internet, your tech savvy grandmother. I used to have one. Write down a definition and an example for low tech. So the first one is just words, but the second activity, 2 minutes, use any resource you can, write down a definition and then give an example for low tech. And then we will share definitions when we're done. So, great. I hope you were able to come up with some definitions of low tech. And again, it's not a wrong or right answer of what low tech entails, but I will be diving into some definitions that I've come up with that I think are helpful and will be useful in these scenarios. So I'll build that up in the next few slides. So when we think about the promise of data in the digital age, say data is ubiquitous right now and holds this promise for changing systems, changing behavior, just improving lives, and delving a little bit more into the promise of data itself today. So I like to use this diagram by Rachel Schatz and Kathy O'Neill from their book Doing Data Science. And what you really want to pay attention to is that given the real world, if we go through this entire process, we'll be able to make better decisions and also build better data products that have an impact on the world. So when you think about it, whether it's a government being able to make better decisions about how it utilizes its resources, limited resources for the benefit of the society, or whether it's a research institution or even a hospital being able to build a better data product to be able to get better utilization of resources to patients in the best way. To some extent, people even think about precision medicine or individualized medicine as opposed to generalized. So that is the hope in terms of data. As you can see, there's an entire process that seems to be very complicated. You need to be able to collect the data, process it, clean it, explore the data, use some algorithm sometimes and visualize and be able to communicate that. But if you're able to get through all that, you'll be able to get the benefits of making better decisions and building better products. Now, if that is the case and the promise of data holds true for society, then we need to make people more data literate. And I like the definition of data literacy by the Center for Humanitarian Data. You should check out their reports. We are all data people. And the definitions they give, I think, is something that I've come to ascribe to. They say data literacy is a comfort and fluency in terms and concepts related to data. So how you get it, analyze it, use it. It also includes the ability to ask the right questions, and even if you are not doing the analysis. So that's kind of important, that basic literacy in terms of being able to engage with data for the right decisions. So given that we as data trainers who want to make people literate, stakeholders literate in data across board, I've set out to have different initiatives, but one of the things that I noticed is the fact that traditional data literacy efforts usually try moving stakeholders to existing levels of data skills and tools. And what do I mean by that? I have categorized that in two main aspects. One aspect is upskilling, and where a data stakeholder is given the skills that allow her to access existing data literacy paradigms. So an example would be you teaching a journalist how to scrape PDF data using a tool called Tabular so that it can become what we term as more machine readable. And then the other aspect is what I call up-tooling. So where a data stakeholder is encouraged or supported to access existing data tools. So an example could be requiring a civic technologist to sign up for a bank card or account in order for them to access cloud services. Now, a good way to visualize this is if you think about data stakeholders being on one end of the spectrum on the left, and then the data skills and the tools that they need being on the other side. The current paradigm or approach tries to get them to move to that side. So they have to some extent be pulled there or somehow pushed over to that side in that sense. Now, if we think about the promise of data, what I and others started notice was that there was little or no data-enabled practices from these data stakeholders, even after we trained them. So whether you're talking about freelance journalists or advocacy groups or mayor's offices in even some high-income countries, procurement authorities, tech entrepreneurs, and ordinary citizens, that promise of data was not being realized, and we wanted to understand what was happening. And even smallholder farmers, which I kind of am personally drawn or biased towards. And so this, what we noticed was that most of these people were within what we were noticing or terming as resource-constrained environments. And I love this definition by Anderson and Anderson in their paper from 2012. You should check it out. But what they say is they define resource constraints environments to refer to a range of conditions, including material issues such as limited electricity, as well as societal conditions such as low literate populations. That's very important to pay attention to that. Resource-constrained environments have these kinds of populations and have these nuances that actually may be having an impact on the ability to access data skills and data tools. Another thing they say is resource-constrained environments provide unique infrastructure, technical, and social constraints that demand innovative design approaches, right? So pay attention to that. And again, why this becomes important when it comes to thinking about low-tech data stakeholders. So the question was, if data has this promise, why are these people not able to access it despite being able to access data literacy trainings? And one of the tenets of the promise of data is actually based on the values of big data, right? Initially it was 4 V's, now it's about 7 V's. But a lot of the promise of data science, of data in the digital age, was based on the ability to be able to store a huge volume of data, be able to analyze a variety of data, be able to capture it at very high velocity or speed, have the skills to be able to deal with the variability in terms of data, tools to visualize data, and all these values were based on the need to have resources that can deal with this. So whether it's infrastructure or whether it's actually the internal capacity, and a large number of the data stakeholders usually do not have this. So they are actually resource constraints, and this is what is limiting them from being able to tap into that promise of data. So I think with this, then we need to rethink how we are doing data literacy. And this is where comes the definition of low tech. From there, I think about low tech in two dimensions. Low tech being low technical data skills or knowledge. So for example, data stakeholders with little or no exposure to non-smartphone operating systems. Why is that important? To some extent, a lot of data literacy trainings or initiatives require the ability to interface with an operating system, Windows, Mac, Ubuntu. But to some extent, a lot of people, especially in this age, young people are getting introduced to the digital age through their smartphones. And sometimes they can actually access the interfaces that currently exist in these platforms. So it becomes a barrier. Low English or other popular language proficiency. So whether it's English, Spanish, French, Portuguese, some of the major, most of the time, European languages, become a limiting barrier because a lot of the content and resources are not accessible to people. So for somebody who's based in Kenya, used to Swahili or Ghana, used to Twi, it becomes an additional barrier for them. No programming background. A lot of the power of data comes in your ability to sometimes program. And that inherent assumption or requirement actually has some cultural, societal nuances that need to be overcome in order for people to access this. So low technical data skills or knowledge. The other dimension is low access to technological tools or processes. So no formal bank account. What does that mean? St. David, the bank accounts have nothing to do with being able to. Oh, yes, they do. If the tools that people need to access are based on a cloud provider and you need to sign up for you to be able to register to access, you need to put in a credit card and you do not have a bank account, that becomes a limitation. Limited internet connectivity. Most of the tools that we use in the space require some level of internet, and some of these stakeholders exist in areas of a stable internet and cannot be able to access this on a continuous basis. So the fact that you need to analyze what a batch data process and have to have your computer connected becomes inaccessible. The fact that you need to visualize something and it has to be live online becomes inaccessible to some of these stakeholders. No or slow computing device. At this, sometimes some of these software require you to have what a minimum of 4 gigabytes of RAM for it to work. Even with R, there are memory constraints that exist. Yes, there are improvements, but still, when you have stakeholders who are using a computer that has just 1 gigabyte of RAM or memory, that becomes an issue because they are not able to engage with some of these tools, which become an additional hurdle. And most of these stakeholders actually use manual data processes, paper-based. This is what they're used to. This is what they can afford. That's the reality of it. So what does it mean to actually get them to adopt data literacy skills when it's assumed that they're using digital services? So the next phase of what I'm going to be talking about is some scenarios, and these are based on real world experiences that I have abstracted a little bit just to not pay attention to the individuals necessarily or the context, but these are real world examples that I dealt with my team members and got me to start rethinking how we approach data literacy. So I'm going to walk through these scenarios. Pay attention to them because there'll be an exercise I'll encourage you to do that will be helpful as we are building up on our skills. So the first is freelance journalists interested in data journalism. So a group of 6 freelance journalists are interested in being trained in data journalism skills. Can you design a training for them? And again, all these are abstracted with little information for now, but really think about how you would deal with this if you had to. The next one is advocacy group doing data collection. So an advocacy group has received funding to run a data collection project to evaluate the root causes of failure in the local government areas and how effective budget controls brings about efficient governance in the local government system. Again, great goal objective. How would you help them achieve this? So data-driven national chapters of advocacy groups. So an international advocacy group has provided funding to run training for members of their European chapters in data-driven decision-making. How would you design a data literacy project, initiative, program to help them with this? Open data for smallholder farmers. As part of an open data project, you have been asked to organize an open data workshop for 40 farmers. How do you go about this? Open data standards for a procurement authority. In order to implement a new procurement system, you need to provide training to key stakeholders within a procurement authority. How would you make this happen? And then finally, as a bonus scenario, travel scholarship for new data community members. So a new member of your data community has been given a scholarship to attend a vital international data conference that will allow them to build her skills and network. You are responsible for getting her to the conference and back. Now, I listed out these scenarios for you to really think about how you go about designing a data literacy approach for that. And here is the individual activity that I'll ask you to do for 5 minutes. So pick one scenario from the list in the Etherpad that you're interested in. Note you'll be working on this scenario for the next 20 minutes, so choose wisely. Well, add your name in to the scenario you've chosen. This will help us really break out into breakout groups. And then the task specifically is make a high level list of activities or resources you would need to get this done. So you pick that activity or the scenario, what high level activities or resources you need to get this done. And then make a list of questions you need answered. So pause for 5 minutes and let you work on this. All right, I hope it was a good activity, and the point of this was for each of you to really think about how you will currently approach one of these activities. Again, there isn't a right or wrong answers, but I think the value of this exercise is the fact that you have to think about this. I abstracted some information, but now I'm gonna provide some additional details that are listed within the Etherpad. All right, so what I'm showing here is some additional constraints that each of these scenarios have. So for people who looked at the freelance journalist interested in journalism scenario, the constraints are that the journalists only have two of their own laptops, and the highest RAM for the laptops is 1 gigabyte. They do not own their own space. They get paid based on the number of stories they report from the field. They are in a country where they have to pay for data by bytes. What does that mean? So you buy 10 gigabytes of data for $5, and it's not unlimited data. So you have to really think about how much data you use when, and then the internet can be stable. So for those working on this scenario, think about these additional constraints. For those working on the advocacy group doing data collection, the constraints are that they are in a country with regular power outages. Internet penetration is limited in the target areas that they want to do data collection in. The team does not have any experience with data collection beyond online and paper surveys. So it's either you send a survey through like an online link and people fill it out, or they do it by paper survey. That's the experience that they have. The team does not have anyone internally with data analysis experience beyond just basic Excel skills. right? And then they were planning actually on using paper-based surveys. And an additional thing I can mention for this team, they were looking at serving about 300 different communities. So that's a lot. For the group that's looking at the data-driven national chapters of advocacy group, the constraints were that most participants are not advanced techies, so they don't consider themselves tech-savvy to understand advanced programming skills. Most chapters can usually afford two or three dedicated staff members. So the director may hire two other people who's doing programs and everybody's doing a bit of everything. So think about that constraint, and then obviously limited operational budgets for them. For those looking at the open data for smallholder farmer scenario, most of the participants, which are the farmers, primarily speak a local language and not English. Most did not finish university. A few may be secondary school or high school as in other places, but most of them did not finish universities. There is no word for data in their language. So that's important to think about. So the idea of like data does not exist in their language. And then most participants, if they were to attend, would lose money from the time away from the farm. So you're designing the session for them, but they would lose time away from the farm. And then most participants have to travel for 2 hours or more to get to the training. For the open data standards for a procurement authority, the constraints are, there are a mix of tech and non-tech savvy stakeholders. So you do have developers, IT people, but you also have accountants, you have just program people. Not all of them have the same level of technical skill. So you have to think about that. They're new to the concept of open data. No dedicated data analysis or data experience, and in a country also with unstable internet. And then finally, for the bonus scenario, in terms of the travel scholarships for new data community member, this community member does not own a bank account. She has no savings. This is the first time she's traveling. And then she needs to get a visa from an embassy in another country within the sub-region, which will be a minimum of 3 days trip involving flying. So again, these constraints will be put on the Etherpad for you to access and think through as you're working on the next activity. So I'm going to switch back to. So for the next activity, which is a group activity, we're going to put you into breakout groups based on the scenarios you chose for 15 minutes. This is what we'd like you to do. Obviously, introduce yourselves when you get into the group, your name, including the pronoun, location, and affiliation. Read out the additional constraint provided for your scenario. Agree on high-level list of activities and resources you would need to get this done. So hopefully you'll be able to consolidate what you did in the individual activity. And then agree on a list of questions you need answered. So that's what the group activity will be about, and looking forward to what you find. Okay, welcome back. I hope the group activity was helpful. I can see a lot of different questions, people asking about how many people, where are they based, do they have access to this and that. And to be honest, I do not have all the answers. I don't think I ever will. But the point of this activity was to get us to think about people. That is very important. Before we go into designing data literacy initiatives, do we understand people and the context within which they exist? Why they do the things that they do? And I hope throughout this activity, it got you to take a pause away from data as a thing, but to think about people and why they do the things that they do. And this was actually what we were forced to do in order to start developing and learning some of these strategies that we are applying at the moment. So again, if you have more questions, that is good, as opposed to answers. It means that you are approaching it the right way, and because enough people are not really thinking about these scenarios to adapt it for. what is going to happen, or what I'm going to list out now, is some strategies that we've ended up developing or adapting from also other people. All these are not strategies that we developed our own, but we started incorporating to make our data literacy approaches much more accessible to these data stakeholders. And again, this is work in progress. Feel free to ask questions as I'm going through them, or you can wait towards the end and I can clarify any questions you have. These will be categorized around general themes, and I'll try to give examples as much as possible. So let's dive in. So in terms of language strategies that we have been using or developing to make things accessible to more stakeholders. So we started providing learning activities or resources in non-globally dominant or official languages, such as English, Spanish, French, right? And again, yes, that should be the case. If you are in a location where all these languages are not unofficial languages, of course, aim for that. It should not be an afterthought. You don't provide English and say, okay, maybe we should provide. No, it has to be a primary thing that you provide. So that hopefully will be easier. But let's take the second scenario, even when you are in a context where a language is predominant, English, Spanish, French. There is also the need to probe about your stakeholders' level of proficiency with the language. So you need to find out how comfortable people are with Spanish or with French when it comes to dealing with some specific technical terms. And that's one of the things that we learned. So for instance, in the first scenario, this is based on a training that we did in Sudan, Sudan being primarily an Arab-speaking country. Aside developing the resources in English, because we, the trainers, were English speakers, we invested heavily into translating everything into Arabic, which became an important resource when even people who were able to speak English still took the Arabic resource and see if they can get a better understanding of what term that is. And you'll be surprised how valuable and how much it boosts confidence when it comes to really being able to pick up some of these skills. So that's an example of that kind of investment. But another example is we start asking our potential audiences about their language proficiency. So this is a question that is from a template of a background survey that we use, where we are asking them in terms of English, but you can replace that with any language of instruction. Are they extremely uncomfortable with it? They feel slightly uncomfortable, comfortable having regular conversations, comfortable having technical conversations. Let's give an example of that. Do you understand words such as standard, schema, tender? You know, looking at some of the jargons and to what extent people feel comfortable with it. And that's very important because this really changes how you end up designing your sessions to make them much more accessible. So this is that in terms of language strategies. Another set of strategies is in terms of accessible data sets. Talking about data, so there should be some element of data. Now, what we've learned or started doing is that we need to prioritize contextualized data. Either we use local data repositories or globally representative ones, such as that from the World Bank, Data Bank, or Food and Agriculture Organizations, or things that are represented. Why? There's always already a barrier in terms of people being able to access concepts, right? As much familiar as you can make it to them, the more likely is that they'll be able to want to connect with it. They'll be able to have an incentive to pursue it more. They'll be able to connect it to the realities that exist around them. If you don't, so an example that I give, in Ghana, we like football, or what people think about soccer. If I'm doing a training where I'm using a sports data set, I should not use baseball. It is foreign. It is unfamiliar. A few people, usually people from privileged backgrounds, will be able to get that. I would rather use a football data set. If I don't, then I have to look at something else that will be much more familiar. So that's what I mean by prioritizing contextualized data sets. And the second thing, if you can't access these data sets already, scrape them. You can scrape PDF tables or even Wikipedia. right? So PDF tables being sometimes annual reports from ministries. Ministries do a lot of reports and they have some tables in there. You can just scrape that using some tools. And again, this would be something that hopefully people will be familiar with. If it's around the time of budgets, people are always interested in budgets. You can use that from the finance ministry. Or Wikipedia country demographic pages. So it can give some information around regions or different breakdowns that people may already, or your stakeholders may already be familiar with. So as an example, when we're doing a training in Tanzania, scrape this data set. Aside even being a good example of or training in scraping websites, it was a useful data set that they could connect to. So they already started engaging. It's like, oh, this has changed. This should be this, why is this? So we already created that conversation and excitement. And this is an example of a PDF. On this side is the PDF itself, which we scraped using Tabular into a machine readable format. And obviously we did some cleaning and it was much more engaging for them. So it's possible to get contextualized data sets. We should not have any excuse not to have contextualized data sets when we are dealing with specific data stakeholders. And finally, this was from an online module that we created for a training institute, again in Tanzania, and we had data sets that were contextualized for them to use. All right, the next category of things is offline resource strategies. So you should aim to design activities that require minimum internet. What I tend to say is design first for offline experiences, see how much you can get out of that, and then you can layer on top the additional online experiences, right? Again, this is really crucial. You may say that, but what if everybody can be online? You don't honestly lose anything from starting in that approach. In case, for instance, if even online settings, something goes wrong, you can still be able to go about getting the key concepts of what you're trying to achieve offline. So one thing I say, download everything you need once. Create a local area network to share files. So one of the things that we've done in some instances is to have a computer set up a local area network that looks like a Wi-Fi that people can connect to and they can get the files that they need. There's also limits having to pass around USB sticks, which can be infectious to computers and all issues. Another thing is invest in offline tools. You as a trainer, as an institution that's doing data literacy, think about what tools exist that work offline. So for us, it's learning how to use a tool called Open Data Kit for data collection when it came to this advocacy group that wanted to do data collection. But there are other offline tools, or if they don't exist, invest the resources to try to develop some of these or design some of these. I think it's important that we think about these scenarios. And then finally, I'm thinking about learning resource formats. So we found PDF, even though they are not as sexy when it comes to being machine readable, they are quite useful for people to be able to just download them and be offline, learn what they need to learn, and then come back online. And also when you're developing websites, making them less data draining. So as much as videos are helpful, switching more to as texts possible as you can make it without also cluttering it. And then even using images that really capture the concept as opposed to having videos, which may not always be accessible to everyone. So really think about that. So for instance, going back to the example of the curriculum that developed for this training institute, as you can see, a lot of it is more text heavy, and then they can click on the link over here and download the PDF, which is an entire module, some of them being about 40 pages with images that depict what they can, again, given the context that they exist in. You can check out the link to this curriculum, it's school-off-data.github.io. You can see the rest over there, it's still active. We also invested School of Data, which I used to work with, invested in designing a guide to mobile data collection that walks people through what data collection is about, the things to think through, how you actually onboard different stakeholders, how you use the tools. And again, this has become a resource that we can share with people who are new to this so that it makes it much more accessible in terms of the support we provide them. All right, the next set of strategies that we've come to learn is foundational competency strategies. What do I mean? It's important that you check for the foundational skills that people need in order to be able to progress through becoming data literate. The best thing you can do for anyone as a learner is to equip them to drive their own learning. And sometimes, if we don't make sure they have these foundational skills or we don't prioritize that, we do a training and assume that they can learn these skills on their own and then they just get disincentivized. So really prioritize that. So everything from the basics of computers to the basics of the web, to the basics of spreadsheets become very critical. We can't say, okay, go learn these skills and then when you're ready, come. It actually either you provide an option for them to take this on or you invest in designing this or integratedness as part of your data literacy approach. And so provide links to already existing modules or create accessible versions. So there's a lot of material that exists around these topics, but sometimes they're just not accessible. We tailor them to make them much more accessible to the context or the data stakeholders. So for instance, for some of the trainings, we've developed entire basics of computers modules where we explain in what is a RAM, because we tended to use a lot of the word a RAM or your memory was not fast enough, or people who ask, why is my computer slow? So them understanding some of these things became vital. Or why is my computer making a lot of noise? Or it keeps on spinning, and explaining to them the difference between SSDs and hard disk drives. Or we would say, connect to the VGA ports or the USB ports, and they'll be like, what is that? So going through and showing different ports and all those things. Again, you are boosting the confidence by enabling them to take ownership of their own learning. Web browsers, again, some of us take it for granted. Open Firefox, open Chrome. Don't use Internet Explorer in some cases, but people do not understand what a web browser is, because sometimes you tell them, I've asked people to enter this link and they ask me, should I do that in Google? Because they do not understand what web browsers is. And again, everything that we can do to reduce that barrier that will enable them to take ownership of their learning is getting them to the point of coming closer to becoming more data literate. Another example of a thing that we've developed is what we call data quizzes, or skills quizzes. So we, instead of asking people, how familiar are you with Excel, or how good are you at Excel? What tended to happen when we asked that question is either people will say, I'm very good, which is they overcompensate or overestimate their ability, or say, I'm not so good, or they underestimate that. And then during the training, you realize that you actually have to spend time really teaching these skills. So what we do now is that we provide a skill, a quiz that actually tests for this skill. So we give them a task to do, open a spreadsheet tool, download this data set, look for this specific figure or calculate this specific thing, and then give us the answer to this. That has tended to be a better gauge of the skill level, and it allows us to intervene better. It also helps us identify potential participants who we need to reach out to specifically and help them get through and have them prior. This is very critical. You cannot assume that everybody's at the same level, or you either end up wasting people's time because you designed the training to be too low to the level, or you end up making it too high and also you spend time doing that, or you have different stakeholders and so you don't know how to structure it to meet those needs. The next one, understanding objectives and challenges. So sometimes we as data trainers, I know I've been guilty of this, we think about what we want to design before we think about what the objectives are. It's either a funder comes to you, and I've had this in several instances, we want to do a training, yay. But what are the objectives? And what I mean by the objectives, it's not even the objectives of the data training, the objectives of the stakeholder. Who are they? What do they do on a day-to-day basis? If they are an advocacy group, what is their advocacy strategy? What is their plan for the 5 years? What are they thinking about? And in what way can them building specific data skills help advance that? It's important to understand this because you then embed your training into that context. There are already incentives that you can tag on to be able to drive their learning. So it becomes very important And again, as I mentioned, we now have these things called background surveys that really try to pull at some of these broader term, long-term objectives. We also have one-on-one calls with people who are either outliers in terms of their preferences or objectives, helps us identify challenges to some extent. There may be women or who cannot attend trainings at specific times. You don't just say, okay, sorry, next one, but try to understand why that is the case. It turns out that sometimes women, because of culture, they have more responsibilities over the weekend. They have to deal with their families. You should then start prioritizing them and not having to have them fit into whatever schedule that you've created. So challenges in terms of language proficiencies, people who can't stay the entire time, people who couldn't complete the quizzes. Really, this gives us additional insights to be able to then structure our training to meet those. So again, here's an example of a background survey. And as you can see, it's given a sense that the goal is to really understand who the participant is. And this is one of the first things we do. I'll show a flowchart of the steps that we've now created to do this, but this is the second thing that we do after we talk to whoever is requesting the training, to get a sense of who the participants are, so that we can now know what kind of training we need to develop. Is it just a webinar? Is it a 5-day training? Is it a 3-month training? Is it a 1-year training? All of these, this really gives us a better sense of what it takes. Terms and jargons. In our space, and I say for us who are technical people, we love to use technical terms. It just makes us feel good sometimes, right? But there's also a barrier that we are creating. So one of the things that I've learned right away is to quickly demystify the terms. And there are cool ways to do this. So one of the things you want to do is you quickly establish familiarity and some comfort for participants with key terms. Just make that possible. Make it demystified. Sometimes I even say, look, I was there before, but I have learned of ways to think about it so that I'm comfortable with it. Make them very relatable. And again, I'll give examples of that. And fun. Fun is a great tool to use, and we can make terms much more fun. Some suggested activities, spectrograms. Spectrogram is a way to let people share different opinions about a statement. So you say, open data will create transparency. There's an agree and disagree. And as people talk indirectly, they are even explaining the term of open data to the level that they understand it, demystifying their own inconsistencies or wrong understanding of it. And to you as a trainer, it also gives you a sense of the different opinions in the room. So it tends to be a great activity to demystify terms. Term definition activities. We created something called keyword charade, where we take a word like API, and we say that, act that out and let us guess what the word is. And so it forces team members to really figure out how they would define that. But that means that they actually have to understand that among themselves, which become a great activity to demystify that. So there's an example of the spectrogram. If you've not tried that out, try that out. And again, I can share strategies later on outside this of ways that we go about it. And then infrastructure provision strategies. Provide an accessible learning space with the required equipment. In Sudan, what we ended up having to invest in is that we had a computer lab that had the same type of computers that had all the software that they need ready for people to use. So that just took care of that. No need for people to have to bring in their own laptops. Again, because we understood what we wanted to do, it was a 9-month program. We had to invest in that and removed one barrier. Include fairness to learners to purchase their own required infrastructure. So in the case of the freelance journalist, and I'll show that in a minute, we had to invest in getting them 6 new laptops that met the standards for the tools that we knew that they were using that could be used by the entire team. So it didn't belong to one person. It belonged to them as an investment again. And then fund data bundles for learners outside trainings. There's a lot of people in these resource constrained environments are in places where data bundles are a huge percentage of an average or median income. Fund that. If you expect them to be able to go look at a visualization outside class, practice things outside the training, fund that. It's critical. So this is I propose budgets, again, I've abstracted away their names, but as you can see, we are funding the working space that they'll be in for the 3 months, the internet that they need, the laptops over there we bought. I don't know what happened.
I think we lost you for a second, but that's okay. You'll be able to edit out this section, okay. Yeah.
So this is an example of a proposed budget for the freelance journalist. And as you can see, we funded their working space, internet, their laptops. So we got laptops for all of them that belong now to the association itself. And it was a critical thing for them. The next thing is participant inclusion strategies. So what we learned is that potential learners from low-income contexts may not have the luxury of free time. What does that mean? Again, most of them are from low-income contexts, so time is very valuable. They don't have free time, free hours. When they leave their job, some of them may have multiple jobs. When they leave that, they have to take care of responsibilities at home because they don't have nannies and all those things, right? So we think about that. Do not assume that. You should prioritize their availability in determining the times of the events as much as possible and provide a stipend to cover their time and transportation. Most of these people would likely want to participate, but they have to do an analysis about the short-term benefits and the long-term benefits. And sometimes long-term benefits are something that's very difficult to fathom right now. So if you can provide a stipend to cover their time and their transportation, it goes a long way to incentivize them towards this. So again, I'm using the example of the budget from the freelance journalists, because they had to be on the field a lot and get stories from them, telling them to be part of this training that will have a medium and long-term benefits. We had to also think about their time, so we provided allowances for them. Again, this is not quote unquote bribing them to come for the training because they should, but it's really paying attention to their context and the realities that they want to learn this, but they also have these constraints. And then another thing we learned is really thinking about embedded support. So many learners, as I mentioned, are not able to replicate the learnings outside trainings. That's a reality. I don't have stats on this, but it's something at least that we saw a lot of. So don't leave them on their own after the training. We now try to bake in post-event outreach or check-ins into our approach. So whether it's 3 weeks after the training, 3 months, 6 months after the training, and to some extent, as much as possible that you can, again, thinking about this when you're designing the project or the initiative, fund a project for them to do after the training, right? So if it's for journalists, fund them right doing a data journalism story. Or in other cases that we've done, we've also funded data experts to sit within the organization where they come and help them really drive this forward, because there's also an aspect of changing culture when it comes to data. And so really having an expert who will really help them move this along in their real context becomes quite helpful. And then this is the last thing that we've also learned is that starting to think about the short-term benefits of data literacy. So sometimes data literacy or the promise of data sells this. If you learn the skills in the future, in this long term, you'll be able to get all these benefits. For a lot of people, that just doesn't work just because of the realities they exist in. So we had to think about ways to demonstrate the immediate application for learners. So how can it bring improvement to what they do? So can it increase access to job opportunities or income? So is there a way that people who participate in this training either get access to now employment opportunities? Well, don't steal them away from their own organizations, but if there's a training that's being had in the area or other organizations that need training, instead of you coming from a long distance to deliver this, can they deliver that themselves and get paid for that? Can you demonstrate how it reduces their existing workload that they have? If somebody at the end of the month or at the end of the quarter has to go into PDF documents and be able to find all the figures they need to be able to write a report, is there a way that you can show that, oh, if you actually go through this process. You learn how to scrape it, you reduce it by this much. You can do this in actually a short time. That actually becomes a better incentive. And also better results. The fact that they are not spending time looking for errors and things that would have affected some decisions that they made. But because of now the resiliency, the fact that they're able to reproduce things easily, they're able to collaborate, it gives better results. All these potentially become short-term benefits, and demonstrate that right away becomes helpful. So these are, again, some strategies, but now it has led to the development of this framework that is still being developed and improved. So now when we receive a request for data literacy training, the first thing we do is that we have what we call a training assessment call. This is to do with whoever is requesting the training. It can be an organizer, a funder, get a sense of the background, all the information that we need, the details of who the potential participants are. And sometimes we decline. It's okay to decline a training. It's not about us. It's not about the fact that we can check a box. It's about really having an impact on people. So if you don't think you can deliver it to the level that needs to, decline that. If we accept it, the first thing that we do is what we call a participant background survey, which I talked about, getting to know who the potential participants are. What do they do? Where are they located? What is their language proficiency? What problems do they solve on their job? Why do they think data capacity building will help them become better? And just getting a sense of what they know and who they are. And then we do what I mentioned, the skills quiz, the pre-event skills quiz, to get a sense of the skills they need in order to access what type of training we're thinking about, or what training we can develop. The select participant one-on-one calls are for identify people who mention preferences, challenges, have a conversation with them. Usually this can be 15 minutes to 30 minutes. Sometimes it can even go over, but it's also reducing the barrier to any kind of discomfort, assuring people that you're thinking about their context, but it's also helping you account for this in your training. Once you have that, then you can develop the event outline and agenda. This is just a draft of the flow. If it's a 1-day training or a half day, or if it's actually a 3-month program or a 1-year program, just coming with that high level outline, sharing that with the organizers, some participants. And again, that's the benefit of that one-on-one call. You can go back and check with them, see how this feels like. And then when that is approved, now we come to the delivery stage. Sharing the participants' resources. So share that ahead of time. Don't share that when the training is about to happen, so that some people can access it before. People who are limited with time can have enough time to be able to look through. It also lets you validate whether it's accessible to them in the context that they exist before they even come to the training. We used to have the pre-event survey, but we took that out. And what the pre-event survey was doing is, on the day of the training, people will fill out a survey and ask them, what is your level of skill? What is this and all that? And we found that it wasn't actually that useful. So we've taken that out. And now this is where the training itself, the data literacy training or package, where you have either the slides, you have the quizzes, the exercises, the labs, all that as a package that you can use, but also making that even available in a way that participants themselves can use later on, without you there. And then we do a post-event survey to get a sense of, okay, how much capable do they feel? This is all about feeling. This is also about their feedback on the training so far, things that we can adjust later on. We do a post-event debrief call, again, with the organizers and some participants to identify things that work, things that didn't work, things that can be improved in terms of the cycle and the flow. We do a post-event skills quiz, either 3 weeks afterwards, 3 months afterwards, 6 months afterwards, continuously. And the whole idea of really following up and helping enable participants to get to the level of data literacy enablement that they need. And then the most important thing, supporting that enabling environment. So either you fund a project or you fund data experts to do that. And again, this should be the ideal goal that we're aiming for. Obviously, in some circumstances, you can't reach all these things, but at least we should try to get to that point and not just isolate it to deliver training and then leave. And the lessons really come back and start the process. And we found, at least in the context that we've worked in, aiming for a minimum time of 6 weeks between when the request comes to when you deliver the first training. It gives you enough time to reach out to participants, get enough responses, understand if something comes up, why they weren't able to respond, set up all these calls, give them enough time to access the resources. Sometimes people have to do learning of the basics of compute. All these things become important. And so a minimum of 6 weeks. Obviously, there are some cases where this would be different, but if you're not aiming for this, if it's 2 weeks of training and you're trying to do this, you are just trying to check a box most of the time. So we've just given ourselves enough time, not for yourself, but also for participants to think about their circumstances to access this. So with that, I will pause here in case there are any questions and clarifications. I know I went through a lot, but again, these are some strategies. Sarah, do you have any questions?
No, none right now.
Okay, great. So with that, I will summarize in this way is that we need to adopt our data literacy approaches to maximize long-term success. It is not about us as trainers or tech-savvy people. We need to think about basic skills that these data stakeholders have. We need to prepare for slow or no internet, assess competencies, and plan for longevity. And so what we are learning and to some extent proposing and asking most of us to really think about is with data stakeholders on one side and data skills, data tools on the other side, can we now move the data skills and the data tools to the stakeholders? Or better yet, these stakeholders have already shown an interest to learn these skills. So they're taking steps. Can we start moving much closer to them faster by making our data literacy approaches much more accessible? There are a lot of organizations doing some of this work. I will not sit here and make it seem like I'm the only one doing. There are a lot of organizations doing that. Some of my work has benefited from them. So School of Data has been doing great work around this with their fellows program, with bespoke trainings that they do for different organizations, with the content that they provide in different languages, but also the resources they are building. CarpentryCon, great organization that is really thinking about what is the best way to equip different stakeholders to become literate in the data skills that they need. So doing great work around that. And even CarpentryCon at home is a testament to that. And then finally, OpenCider, very young new organization. I forget the full definition of the term, but their whole point is to make computational skills much more inclusive to different audiences. They have a talk next week. So really check that out. They will be doing a deep dive and building some of these content. And also I will be sharing some of the templates that we have with them so that it makes it easy for you to develop this. And with that, thank you for having me. You can reach me at david@adore, that's adore.org. On Twitter, I'm quite active on Twitter at sdopoku. So thank you again. And it was such a pleasure to share with you. And I hope that you start thinking about more accessible ways to reach some of these audiences.
Thank you so much, David. I have one question. You mentioned that after a series of School of Data workshops, you decided to deprecate the pre-workshop surveys, but you kept running the pre-workshop data skills tests. And my question is, how long does it take for people to do the skills tests, and do they get responses or results for how they did in these tests before they come to the workshop, or how are the results fed back to them, and how are they exactly used to design the workshops, if at all?
Yes. So the skills quiz is, I guess it has two benefits, but the good thing about it is you are doing a task-based activity. So you are, the fact that you're able to get through it is just validation of the fact that you have these specific skills. Mm-hmm. And for those who are not able to get through it, then that is where we reach out to them. We have this one-on-one calls and walking them through that. Again, we've not perfected that. Some of the challenges that we are facing or we have faced is for people who can access things online, right? Mm-hmm. Paper-based. how do you get it to them?
Yeah.
So that length of time, that back and forth, really thinking about that. And that's why we're saying 6 weeks, because some of these contexts, sometimes we've sent it out and we've not heard from people in 2 weeks. So we have to reach out again. We have to call and all this way. It's not a perfect process, and we're still trying to figure out ways to make it much better. Yeah. But the goal of the skills quiz is to give them a better sense of what they are skills with. And just by the design, the fact that they're able to get through the tasks would mean that they have these basic skills that we are looking for. And for those who are not able to, we can have a call with them and recommend trainings or resources they can use as part of the training before, and then see if they can get through that text. Most of the time we found out that, especially with Excel, it's not because people are challenged, it's just they're just not familiar with it. So really walking them through and saying, oh, this is actually what this means and what that does, and then they're able to build that confidence and get through that. And this has tended to be better than the skill, the pre-event quiz, which was literally just asking people at the beginning of an event to tell you what skills they have. That really wasn't a useful thing to do, even though sometimes they are the same questions that you then ask at the end of the event. It's also still a short time to be able to get that assessment. So we don't use the pre-event surveys as assessing skill level. We use it more to get feedback on the training itself, other things that we could have done better. The skills quiz rather are those quizzes that then show ability to demonstrate specific skills.
Okay, that makes sense. Thank you.
That's a very good question. Thank you for asking that. All right. Well, again, I hope you have more questions around this. And the point of this, the skills up, was that can we get us thinking about these scenarios? Can we think about ways that we can make this much more accessible? And if that's what you're going through at the moment, then you are on the right track. And I hope more people will be thinking about this as we are designing tools and skills, and even primarily people within low-tech context and resource environment should be part of this design of skills and tools. We should have people thinking about this from these contexts, and I believe it has more benefits for us. So with that, I will say thank you again to the Carpentries for having me and for all of you for joining, and looking forward to seeing what you develop through this. Thanks.
Amazing.